know.
Hi, thanks for joining us today. I'm Kevin Kay. I'm the president of Spike TV. Khalif Browder's story is a really important one to tell. It's the story of an ambitious young man with his whole life in front of him who became a victim of the criminal justice system. A young man who spent an unthinkable 3 years in prison, including 2 years in solitary confinement, awaiting trial for a crime he didn't commit and for which, unbelievably, he was never charged. It's a story that's so relevant today, one that we feel will honor Khalif's legacy and we believe will inspire much needed change. When Harvey Weinstein, who has been a great friend, a great supporter, a great partner of Spike from day one, brought this project to us, I immediately knew that we had to do it. I remember a few years back when Khalif's story came to light, including that incredibly moving piece in The New Yorker. Anyone who has followed Khalif's journey realized that something has to be done about our current criminal justice system. It's time for change, and it's time to tell Khalif's story. We're thrilled to partner with the very best in the business to tell that story. The Weinstein Company, of course, the talented filmmakers who you'll meet later, and of course, Sean, Jay-Z, Carter, and Roc Nation. I'd also like to thank Vanita Browder and the Browder family for their support. They're here with us today. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Harvey Weinstein from the Weinstein Company. Harvey.
Well, I want to thank Kevin and Sharon, and also say when Jay and Roc Nation made the deal with the Weinstein Company, this was the first project he brought to us. And Kevin and Spike stepped up in a big way. And, you know, with one meeting, they greenlit the project. So we announced our first lip deal on last Thursday. And just to show you how, as Jay said, how efficient we are as a partnership, four of the episodes are filmed already. So I think that's good for a week now. Okay. Those are the jokes. Should I say I'm Mike Pence? You know, whatever. and deflect every question. This is Jenner First, you know, our director. He made a name for himself with documentaries like Brick City and Chicagoland. Next to him is Nick Sandow, our writer and executive producer. You might know Nick from Orange is the New Black as an actor, but he is a filmmaker, including making a movie called The Wannabe, executive produced by Marty Scorsese. In the audience, Mike Gasparo.
I just put that together. Sorry.
In the audience is Mike Gasparo, the series producer, and Julia Nason, the series executive producer. These two here. So, let me just get to this. I want to introduce Jay, and I don't mean to embarrass him. This might embarrass him, but I really mean this. You know, and this is sincere. He is truly a Renaissance man. The work that he does in the arts, you know, as a musician, as a music producer, as a film producer, television producer, stage producer, you know, is on the cutting edge, you know, and educates us, teaches us, and certainly me, you know, as a huge fan. His company title is terrific. I mean, it's artists running, you know, their own music streaming, and it keeps growing and growing and growing, and we use it for movies and content and, you know, just one of the true great innovators. And I'm so pleased. We've known each other over the course of years. I just make no mistake. This was, you know, I must be honest. Jay brought this project to us. You know, as a team, we brought this to Spike. You know, it's an amazing start to, I think, an amazing partnership, you know, between us. There'll be projects like this. There'll be projects that are entertaining, you know, as well. But everything will have, you know, I think, something to say that's important. And it's just great that the team, you know, is doing this. So I just want to introduce truly what I said before, a Renaissance man, and for me, a friend, Jay-Z.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Thank you, Spike, for helping us tell this important tale. It's a very timely story. I look at Khalif Browder as a modern-day prophet. Our prophets come in many different shapes, forms, and different mediums or whatever. This young man, just by, you know, the fact that he brought all of us here today, lets you know just how powerful of a soul he was. I came across this story in the New Yorker, and I called Shaka immediately. Shaka Pilgrim, who worked with me forever, she's sitting here today. I called Shaka and I said, "Shaka, I need to meet this young man. Could you find him?" And you know, I was thinking that you know it would take a while. And she called me back. And, my phone kept ringing. I didn't answer because sometimes I don't answer a call. And she kept calling, so I knew it was important. And I was like, "Okay." And she said, "You're not going to believe this." She was at another event and ran across the guy that was his lawyer who was helping him out, who was a brilliant young man who was helping Khalif seek justice. And it just happened that day. So it was meant to happen. And Khalif came to the office and we met. I just wanted to give him words of encouragement that I saw his story and that I'm proud of him for making it through and to keep pushing. And told me that he was going to college. And for me, you know, this story, you know, in the movies, in some movies that are told, this story ends differently. Then I got a phone call from Shaka, and she told me that Khalif had taken his own life. And, you know, I was thrown, of course, and I was asking myself, man, this story doesn't end like this. It's not supposed to end this way. That's not how the story goes. Not in the movies, not in real life. And shortly thereafter, things start happening. Obama talked about, you know, a crime bill and eliminating solitary confinement for minors. And I know that was Khalif. And, you know, all these things start happening and, you know, we came across these fabulous filmmakers and everything just start happening the way it should happen. And I knew right there that, you know, he was a prophet. You know, some of our prophets, you know, go in tragedy. Martin Luther King ends tragically, but what comes from it, the life and the next iteration of, and the lives saved, and how this young man has moved culture forward, is incredible. And I think you should be incredibly, and you are incredibly proud of your son and what he's accomplished. And I know it's difficult for you and the family to not have him, to not be able to speak to him, but he's here. He's here today. He's here today, and he's done more in 19 years than a lot of us would do in a lifetime. So on that note, I would like to thank you for bringing us Khalif's energy into this world, and I would like to introduce his beautiful mother so she can speak. And I want to thank all the people involved with us telling this very important story. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. I'm very glad to be here today. And I want to acknowledge the organization of Stop Solitary for Kids. It's a very important organization. And of which I and Mr. Prestia are both board members. Stop Solitary for Kids is a national campaign to end solitary confinement for youths in both juvenile and adult facilities in the U.S. This is a very important organization, and I'm very thankful that this series is aligning itself with this work of this organization. It's an awesome organization. It's too late, unfortunately, for my son Khalif, but it will definitely benefit other youths so that they won't have to endure what my son did. And thank you for your tireless work.
Okay, thank you, everybody. Before we open up for questions, we're gonna see a clip. It's only for this room only, so please, no recording. You put your cameras down when we play the clip. So again, thank you so much. We're gonna show the clip and then come back with some questions. Okay, we're going to open up some questions from the media. We have some guys with mics walking around.
Hi, I'm Chloe with CNN. This question is for Mr. Carter. What do you think is the answer to stopping police brutality against African-American men in this country?
Compassion. You have compassion for someone's plight, things that they go through. We're all going to fall short of grace at times. You know, judgment is, you know, the enemy of compassion. And, you know, when you are able to identify that, yeah, we're all not perfect, and we may make mistakes, all of us, every single one of us in here. And when you have compassion on what someone's going through and their plight, you know, and also you have to have, I believe, my personal opinion, that having a camera on someone creates more distrust. If we have to have an exchange and it has to be recorded, something's wrong there. Something's broken. So a camera can't fix the, you know, the relationship between a person that's hired to protect and serve and society. It has to be a relationship. It has to be respect on both sides.
Hi there. I'm Miles Hanser from The Fader. I have a question for Mr. Carter. I know in your remarks just now you mentioned that President Obama worked on repairing some of the problems with mass incarceration in this country. Do you believe that any of the presidential candidates running for office will continue that legacy? And if so, which ones?
You have hopes. You know, you have hopes that we're all moving forward as a society. Because it's not a political issue, it's a human issue. It's a story of compassion and empathy. And in order for us to move forward, this conversation needs to move forward. And it's just life. It's life. It's and where we are right now, it's just imagine a metaphor. If you're going down a road and a sign says end of the road in 15 feet, and you take your car and you just barrel past it, you know, at some point you're gonna go off a cliff. That's just the way the world works, you know. And you know, we need to keep pushing the conversation forward. And no, again, it's not a political issue. It's a human issue, and I would hope that any human being would know that that's the right thing to do.
Hi, my name is Peter Splendoria. I'm with the Daily News. My question is also for Mr. Carter. So obviously, the story of Khalif Browder is very important to tell, and that was a very powerful clip you just showed us. My question is, how do you hope that viewers are impacted by the series, as well as like decision makers within society?
It's the kind of story, Khalif's is the kind of story that you can't ignore. 16 years old, right? If everyone in here imagined their cousin, nephew, little brother, 16 years old, getting arrested in America, you know, land of the free, home of the brave, and everyone's innocent until proven guilty. And this young man at 16 was arrested and held in Rikers Island for 3 years. 3 years where he was in solitary confinement and subjected. That's real footage. That's not doctored footage. These guys did a beautiful job with going into the archives and getting all these. This is real footage. And this is a real woman with real pain. And you can imagine that. You know, seeing that, it's very hard to ignore. You know, it's very hard to ignore. And it's our job. It's our job to use all our mediums, your job, my job, Harvey's job, the people at Spike, to use our voice to get these stories out so we can have a discussion about it and we can move forward and fix things. because it's broken currently.
Hi, good morning. My name's Tashar from the New York Post. My question is for Mr. Carter as well. Does it strike a chord to you or a nerve when you mention this product and people may not know who Caliph is?
No. You know, everything happens at its time, you know. Are you asking me that,
well,
does it bother me when people don't
know? A lot of people don't know this case and don't know who he is. So does it strike a chord, like, you know, does it strike
a chord? No, no, not at all. That's why we're doing this. That's why everyone is here and, you know, we're here to bring awareness and light to Caliph's story, the reason we're here. So, no, it doesn't.
And by the time we're done, everybody will know the story, not only in America, but globally.
Can you talk about, Cynthia Littleton with Variety, can you talk a little more specifically about how you have gotten that footage of the interrogation? Presumably you had to get it from law enforcement.
That's the directors.
Law enforcement. Yeah. And also for Harvey and Sean, can you talk about, of all the places you could have taken this project, why was Spike TV the fit?
Well, I can't reveal my sources, but I obtained it, and it's important for people to see this young 16-year-old, teenager. And very ironic that the clock is zoomed in on, because that was really the minute, the second, that his life took a dramatic and horrible turn, and that's how fragile his life was, and many young men's life, young people of color's life is in America, that one simple second, one five-minute interaction can change your life forever, and it did for Caliph Browder. So I'm glad we obtained it, and I think it's an important thing to kind of look at.
You want to answer the question about Spike?
Yeah.
Why'd you bring it to me?
Kevin and Sharon, you know, Sharon's going to get the Medal of Honor. She deals with my brother, you know, a lot. So David Glasser, who's done an amazing job, you know, on this project, and Megan, you know, our head of TV, were in conversations with Kevin about something else. He said, I want to revolutionize, you know, and do amazing things, you know, with the network. And we talked to him about this project, and he wouldn't let us out of the room. I mean, it was just like we were on our way to see The Usual Suspects, so to speak. And Jay, you know, came from remote. We made a pitch, and that was it. I mean, they just said, we're doing it, and you're not seeing anybody else. And when somebody's that passionate in the room, you know that they're going to follow through and go all the way. You know, you make, you know, TV, you make deals all the time, and then they say, oh, we didn't promote it, oh, we didn't do it. This is the kind of way the story gets to be told in answer to your question, a press conference today, you know, and then the fact that they have that footage is amazing. And the fact that Caliph is what they told me, he was smart enough to know where the camera was, you know. In other words, when they dragged him off to get beaten, you know, whatever, you notice he goes back to where the camera was. He had that innate sense, maybe the foresight, to know that this was going to happen. So I think Kevin, Doug Herzog, the head of the networks, I think they put on the line. And when you see that kind of passion, I'm never going to say no to that.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we don't do a lot of these, right? And so we can pay a lot of attention to it. You know, we're in 90 million homes. We have an audience that we know is interested in justice. And this is a story, hopefully, about justice, ultimately. But, you know, bringing it to us gives us, we will be behind it. We will market it. We will promote it. We want this story to be heard and told. And I think that, you know, that's part of the reason that this team brought it to us, because they know that we're not going to bury it. We're going to tell it and promote it.
And, you know, just our history in documentaries, as I'm sure some of you know, we started with The Thin Blue Line. Randall Adams was in jail. And relentlessly, we released the movie 12 times in Dallas, where he was, and that to get that district attorney and Randall Adams walked out of jail into my office. So I know what the power of a movie can do. We did Citizen 4, which won the Oscar. We did Fahrenheit 9/11. Watch that movie now and see how unbelievably, you know, when Jay talks about prophecy, it's incredible. Or Sicko, or, you know, and, you know, we know that these kind of things, and you know, the kind of things, you know, can even 20 feet from stardom. We took those backup singers who never got any attention, now are headlining, working all the time, and also set a career path for others. So this is not our first rodeo, and we're only going to go, you know, to make a change where we can have the impact. And Sean brought the project to us, so we had no idea. I'm going to be honest, I didn't even know who Khalif was until Sean showed us footage and talked to us about the project. And now I want to make sure everybody knows.
Hi, Corey Groh from Rolling Stone. I was just wondering, you know, there's obviously a lot to his story about the, you know, the criminal justice system. There's a lot to his story about the implications of solitary confinement. You know, he's a 16-year-old. What is it that you hope people take away after watching this from Khalif's story?
It's to you.
Well, just that this young man got dealt a horrible hand in the way it happened, and that his story and that his life, you know, inspires others. And saves others' lives. I think it's very clear that solitary confinement for a 16-year-old is wrong to every single person in here. I think that's is inhumane. It's inhumane. It's difficult for me to find the words. It's so inhumane. It's like, yeah, I hope that people see the story and. I mean, because we're the voice, the society. We affect change. We can change everything. You know, it's us. It's our voices. Our voices are stronger than ever. And, you know, if everyone in this room is like, I don't agree with this happening to a 16-year-old, and that won't happen again. It won't happen again. It's that simple. Thank you.
Hi, Gabrielle from Us Weekly Magazine. My question's for Mr. Carter. Do you see this project as something that families should watch together to open the lines of communication about Khalif's story? And if so, what age would you show it to your own kid?
Yeah, I think it's very important. And I think that's for you to, you know, your child. You know, some children are more mature at, you know, age is just the amount of time you've been on the earth. It's not. It doesn't signify your level of knowledge or intelligence. And again, information means nothing. You can have all the information in the world, inspiration. And if you feel that your child would be inspired by a story like this, inspired to have compassion, inspired to change, inspired to stand up for change, then, you know, that's a parent's decision. You know, for me, my child is... I talk to my child as I speak with you ever since she was born. So, you know, I probably show it to her before most people would think that is acceptable. But my child is my child. She's, you know, that's our relationship. It depends on the relationship that you have with your child and how much you trust your child to handle certain information, because it's scenes in there that's pretty hardcore, and she may, or he may, your child may get like not be able to sleep at night. But it's the reality, it's the harsh realities of, you know, of what transpired, and so that's a choice for you. Did I answer?
Any more questions?
Hi, Marcus Jones from BuzzFeed. My question is for Mr. Carter. So a lot of rappers specifically, a lot of musicians get into producing film and TV, but a lot of rappers have been successful at it. Why do you think that is, and what do you bring to the table as a producer?
I guess me personally, I just found that, I thought of this on the way here, that I tell stories through different mediums. Sometimes I tell it through spoken words. Sometimes I tell it through television, sometimes television and film. Sometimes I tell it through fabric, you know, but it's all part of the same story. And it's all part of, you know, flawed characters finding some sort of evolution. And the medium doesn't matter. So I think with artists in general, we have a sensitivity to telling stories. And the medium doesn't matter, whether we're, you know, recording in a studio, shooting a video, or producing film. It all has that same line of, you know, telling stories and sensitivity to it. And so when you really tapped into it and you're doing it for the, you know, right reasons, you'll be successful at it because it's all just storytelling.
I can tell you that Jay's going to produce the Richard Pryor movie with Lee Daniels directing. So, I mean, each time, you know, I think you'll see these projects be something that hit the cultural zeitgeist, you know. One day we'll find something really commercial to do. But not now. We're going to make
it. Richard Pryor's make commercial. I mean, Rich, you don't get more commercial. This is our conversation after, by the way.
Exactly.
There's nothing more commercial than Richard Pryor. His story is an American story. Yes. You'll understand how many lives he's touched. I mean, from every single comedian to rappers like Biggie Smalls. Well, I won't recite the lyric because we got Miss Browder in the audience, but y'all know the lyrics.
Right, any more questions?
Hi, my name is Rahel. I'm from the Huffington Post, and I just had a question for Mr. Carter as well. So before Khalif passed away, he stopped by the Huffington Post. We spoke with him. He described his horrific experience in Rikers. So I just wanted to know, how do you hope to sort of further his legacy, and what do you, just furthering his legacy and what your thoughts are on that?
With every single person in the room that's played a part in this, filmmakers, despite to Harvey and, you know, everyone. You know, we hope to put this in front of as many people as we can and, you know, his legacy is, like I said in the opening, you know, you can see it already touching so much change from, you know, the solitary confinement program that Ms. Browder is on the board of, to, you know, Obama's ending the solitary confinement of minors, to even the ivy in the spring. I don't know if y'all saw it in the thing. That was his bedroom window. That's not a plant. That's not something that we shot for film. That's life happening, you know.
Any more questions? Okay. Thank you guys for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.